It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Alireza Salehi Golsefidy from University of California, San Diego, and he's going to speak about spectral gap in perfect algebraic groups over prime fields.
Thanks a lot. Let me thank Alex for inviting me. It's a pleasure to give a talk in this seminar. This is my second time that I'm giving a talk in this seminar. The previous time was on Blackboard. But this time is different. This is a joint work with my graduate student, Siravatsa Srinivas. But we get to our joint work quite towards the end of the talk. So if I get time, I go into the proof a bit. But let's see how much we get. So let me start with basics. Here is the basic. Let's recall what is a group, what is a random walk that's induced by group action. So I give you a group G. Let me start with, let me work with finite groups, even though this can be done in more general setting for compact groups or even more. But let me work with finite groups. So G is a finite group. I give you a set omega and G acts on this set omega. So this set omega, you can think about it like the set G itself. You can think about it as a vector space that G acts on it linearly or via affine transformations. Or you can think about omega as the Fourier inverse of a vector space that G acts on it. So you can think, so this omega in this talk will play these three types of roles. So it's either the group G itself, or a representation of G, or the Fourier inverse of the representation of G. So these are the kind of sets that you have to have in mind. But whatever it is, if I give you a probability measure on G and a probability measure on this set omega, then you can do random walk on this set. And what does that mean? This means you take a random variable with probability law nu, and a sequence of identically distributed independent random variables, x of i's, and you each time allow x of I act on the previous result that you have. So you end up getting this sequence of random variables with values in omega, and the distribution is given by n-fold convolution of the measure, where the n-fold convolution, it's simply the averaging operator on the set of functions. So we average it with respect to the measure mu, and we get. Okay, so now, what do we expect? I mean, what do we want to study when we are dealing with random walks? So essentially the question is what kind of random variable we end up getting. So, and that means I give you a test function F and you ask yourself, okay, what is the expected value of this random variable when I plug it in into the function F? And okay, so let's focus on the case where G acts on itself. And let's say I start at identity and I do random walk with respect to some probability law in G. And for simplicity, I'm going to assume that my probability law is symmetric. This means that the probability of hitting G and G inverse are the same. So then it's quite easy to see that my probability law is getting closer and closer to each distribution on the finite group G. In fact, this is true even for compact groups and when my measure is not symmetric. And this is due to E2, and that shows that you always get convergence to E2 distribution as long as the support is dense inside the compact group. Now, the main question is what is the error term? How can I control the error term? And if you think about it, I mean, as I explained, the random walk is n-fold convolution. This means that I have to work with the convolution operator. And that means I give you a function f. And here I'm working with finite groups, so it's rather easier. I can identify the measure with the distribution function as well. And so it's just the convolution operator of the measure mu. And when we ask ourselves, what is the error term if I subtract, then subtract f by the average, I get a function that's perpendicular to the constant function. So I get a function in L2G circ. So this circ essentially means perpendicular to the constant function. Let me use another color. What happened? screen. Oh, no. The screen. I want to use a different color. Okay, so this means perpendicular to the constant function. So if I give you a, then the error term is about the contraction rate of this operator. So how much am I contracting? And that means the operator norm of this averaging operator. And because I'm assuming mu is symmetric, it's a self-adjoint operator. And so the operator norm is the same as the absolute value of the eigenvalues. So that's why we call it spectral gap. So it's called the spectral gap of this random walk. So if this spectral gap is smaller, then I get a better error term. And as you can see, I mean, the error term tells me how close I am to be uniformly distributed inside this set. So it's a good indication why it can help us to create pseudo-random numbers. So it's a way to create pseudo-random numbers. And it is also used to construct a family of expanders. So what are expanders? They are, so very naively, they are highly connected sparse graphs. So I will give one treatment of expanded graphs. I do not quite go to the trigger constant concept and definition of expanders, which is the better combinatorial definition. But so I will explain it orally, but I did not include it in my notes. So again, what do I mean by expanders? Expanders, okay, so let me provide example for that. So in fact, the first construction was not that easy, but let's focus on KD graphs and then try to understand expanders only for graphs that are coming from groups. So suppose I have a finite group G sub N that's generated by a generating set S sub N. S sub N is a symmetric set. And suppose the cardinality of these generating sets, all of them are fixed. All of them are K. Now I look at the KD graphs. So these KD graphs, all of them are K regular graphs. So assuming the cardinality of G sub N is getting larger and larger, I will end up getting the sparser and sparser graphs. But now I want to, so this takes care of the sparse part of this slide, I mean, this page. When I say the sparse, now you can see that it's essentially about the density of the number of edges that you get between compared to the cardinality of the vertices. So we want to have roughly the same portion of edges compared to vertices. So when it's K regular, of course, it's fixed. It's just K. But now I have to tell you what does highly connected mean. So the combinatorial approach is by saying that if I give you a subset, the number of vertices that you need to cut, or the size of the boundary of this subset of this graph, divided by the cardinality of the set, what is the minimum amount that you get, that's called the trigger constant of the graph, and we want to have a uniform lower bound for it. So from, so I know that you have, most of you know this concept, let me just remind you that this is more kind of L1 property. So it is about L1 property of the functions, and we can describe this kind of trigger constant in terms of L1 functions. But here I am going to present it in terms of L2 property, which is the spectral gap property. So another point of view of thinking about how connected your graph is by saying, when I do random walk on my graph, how fast am I getting it close to each distribution? So if my graph is very connected, then after very few number of steps, I should be roughly everywhere with the same probability. So when I say few, I mean logarithmic in terms of the cardinality of this vertices. So, but that's equivalent to say it's a result, it needs to be proved, but it is equivalent to say that if I have a uniform upper bound on the spectral gap of all these random walks, then we call these, you can treat it as a definition, we call these Cayley graphs to be family of expanders. Okay, so I also found this useful to, I mean, borrowing the concept of Lyapunov exponent from an infinite space random walk to talk about log of this, log of the spectral gap. But here log, I mean, spectral gap is a number less than one, so log will be negative. So negative of this I take and call it the Lyapunov exponent of my random walk. So when you are looking for an upper bound for my spectral gap, it's like finding a lower bound for the Lyapunov exponent. So this treatment, I mean, it is kind of useful because often it's easier to work with additive guys compared to the multiplicative guys. And when I use this kind of Lyapunov exponent, when I do L a step random walk, the Lyapunov exponent would be just L times the previous one. I cannot erase it, okay. So it's L times the Lyapunov of the previous one. This kind of, this notion is sometimes useful mentally. So of course it's not something new, but it is kind of useful to have this kind of language of Lyapunov exponent of the random walk. So this tells me that having a lower bound for Lyapunov exponent of these random walks give me at least family of expanders. Construction of such family was not easy at all, and the first construction was due to Margulis using property T, and so you can think about SL and Z when N is at least 3. Then in that case, Margulis showed that when you look at finite quotients of a group that has property T, when you take your generating set from the mother group S and then give it to all these finite quotients, then you get a family of expanders. So as you see, this this condition N is at least 3 is important for N equals to 2. Of course, it does not have property T, but if I look at the congruence quotients of SL2Z, then it's due to Selberg before this concept of expanders was explored. Selberg actually showed, what he showed implies that SL2 of Z mod out by QZs, the Cayley graphs form a family of expanders, assuming that generators again come from SL2Z, a generating set of SL2Z. And this result had been expanded. Now many people worked on it, but by work of Selberg, Kajdan, Margulis, Burger Sarnak, Klausel, and Klausel Ulmo, we have this beautiful result that if I start with a Q semi-simple group, and they look at the S arithmetic subgroup of it, joint Z with 1 over Q naught, and look at those points of this algebraic group, assuming that it's an infinite group, this is always known to be finitely generated, you pick a generating set, then if I look at this guy mod out by all the integers that are co-prime to Q naught, I get a family of expanders. So this Q run, this Q should be co-prime to Q naught. This is a deep result. It uses, okay, Selberg used closed term and sum. Kajdan used property, I mean, defined property T. Margulis used Kajdan's property T in order to construct expanders. Burgess and Sarnak produced this kind of induction argument that if you have a subgroup that has this this type of property, then you can get it for the larger group. Then using the SL2 result of Selberg, you can get quite a lot of groups with these property, but you do not quite get SL1 of division algebras or unitary groups, and Clausel did that, but this had been done for only arithmetic groups. If you want to allow 1 over Q naught as arithmetic groups, then Clausel and Ulmo took care of that. So quite a lot of work went in order to have this kind of result. But the question is, how much is this property of the group, and how much of it is a property of the group head with a generating set? And that's a question that Lubotsky and Wise ask. So that's the formulation. I give you a family of groups. I give you two different generating sets, S sub n and S sub n prime, but both of them have the same cardinality. If with respect to one of them I get expanders, do I get expanders with respect to the other one? This is a very hard question. In general, it turns out to be false due to work of Lubotsky, Avi, Richardson. Do you remind me, Alexander, who was the third author? I forgot the third author. I know Alex and Richardson. You're mute.
My Zoom. So it was
Alone,
Lubotsky and Richardson. And then there was also the work of Kasabov, I guess, which...
Oh, it was after that. Yeah, that one was after. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so it is essentially a semi-direct product group, a lamp-light kind of group, where the action is not quite mixing. It is a bit mixing, but not quite. And so because of that, so they constructed these groups. But as Alex also pointed out, you can also look at the symmetric group. That's a nicer group to consider. Then Kasabov's result implies that with respect to some generating set, they form expanders, but there are many generating sets with respect to them, they are not expanders. Okay, so in order to understand the subtlety of the question, let's look at Lubotsky's 1-2-3 problem. So what is it? Lubotsky asked, okay, so maybe that question is too hard. How about this question? So I look at SL2FP, I give you this particular generating set, 1 plus minus 3, 0, 1, 1, 0, plus minus 3, 1. Then is this a family of expanders? So it's known that this is a generating set if P is at least 5. And he asked, are the graphs highly connected? Now that we know it's connected. And the reason that it's called 1-2-3 is because when I plug in 1 or 2, so they will be congruent subgroups of SL2Z. So then Selberg's results immediately imply that we do get family of expanders in those cases. But for 3, we get an infinite index subgroup of SL2Z. So the previous known automorphic form techniques and Klosterman sum techniques did not work. So here was the question till the seminal work of Bougain and Gamble. So what they show is much more. So they show that you start with any generating set, but as soon as the girth of the Cayley graph is logarithmic, you get a spectral gap that just depends on how large the girth is. And girth, let me quickly remind you that girth means the smallest loop inside the graph. So, and notice that because the group generated by the generating sets that Lubotsky pointed out is a free group, when you model by P, you get back to identity, you get a loop. When the length of the word is at least logarithmic in terms of P, otherwise mod P, you cannot get identity because you are in a free group and the word is not identity. So this immediately implies Lubotsky's 1-2-3 problem, but it gives more. In fact, it kind of gives an answer to Lubotsky-Wise's question. Okay, maybe not for all the generating sets, but rather for those ones that gives you large depth. Now the question is how crucial this large depth is. If it doesn't have a large girth, what does it mean? This means you have to satisfy a small equation. Can I change it? Can I find pairs in the small product of these guys that do not satisfy such equation? So this is the idea that Brouillard and Gambert explored, combining ideas from the effective Pitts alternative due to Brouillard and the ideas within the proof of Bougain and Gambert. They do not use it as black box. They use ideas within the proof and show that, in fact, Lubotsky-Wise's question does have positive answer. Okay, maybe not for the entire set of SL2FPs, that's still open, but for a very large set of them, P can change in a very large set of primes. Very large means if I sequence them, so the next prime P sub n plus 1 should be at least P sub n plus a very small power of P sub n. So if you have such a thing, then they show that for such a set sequence of primes, they can show it does not depend on the set of generators. So a very strong, nice result that shows independence on the generators. Okay, so now let me go back to Boog and Gamble's technique. I mean, what is it? I mean, how do they produce such a result? What they show is this blue thing. So you have to take this after this thought. Maybe you forget many things, but this should be important. So what they show is that in a finite group, when I give you two random variables, the product should get substantially more random, unless there is an algebraic obstruction. I mean, this is a general kind of phenomenon in many dynamical systems, but they show it in a nice fashion here. So in order to understand this, I have to say, what do I mean random? We have to quantify randomness. For any random variable, there are many forms of entropy that tell us how random a random variable is. So Shannon entropy is the most famous one. But here, what is important is the Rene entropy, and that is negative log of sum of probabilities squared. So if mu is the probability law, and then it is negative log of the L2 norm of mu squared. So if X was equidistributed on a set, then simple computation says that it's log of cardinality of the set. So essentially for equidistribution, all the forms of entropy are the same. And if the entropy is defined correctly, then that should be the maximum entropy. So in many dynamical systems, entropy is getting always larger and larger, and till in limit it converges to the max entropy within the algebraic obstructions. So this is a general kind of philosophy in most of dynamical systems, that your dynamical system has certain algebraic rules that it should apply, obliged, but within that algebraic rules, the entropy is getting larger and larger. And here is a very good example of this general philosophy. So they show that if the entropy of the product doesn't get very large, so if it's at most, the gain of entropy is at most log of k. K is a positive number, a fixed positive number. You can think about it. It's not quite fixed in the setting that we will be using. K will be a fixed power of the cardinality of the group. But for now, this statement is true as soon as k is larger than 100 or something. So if the entropy doesn't gain much, then there should be an algebraic obstruction. What does that mean? This means there should be an approximate subgroup. What does approximate subgroup mean? It means it's symmetric and it has identity. Okay, and if it was a subgroup, when I multiplied it by itself, I end up getting the same set. Here it's not a subgroup, but the amount of shifts that I need is bounded by the number k to power r naught. So in that case, we call it a k to power r naught approximate subgroup. Okay, so I have such a group, such a subset. Now I have a control on the cardinality. So again, remember when I had equidistribution, then the entropy would be precisely log of the support. And here the concept is, again, let me go back before I continue. Let's go back here. If X was equidistributed on the coset GH, and Y was equidistributed on the, this time, right coset HG prime, then X times Y would be equidistributed in the double coset, left and right cosets GHG prime. And you see, the entropy doesn't change. It's all the same. So, and now what we want to say is that that's kind of the abstraction if I change everything to approximate. So X is approximately equidistributed on a left coset of some approximate subgroup. Y is approximately equidistributed on a right coset of an approximate subgroup. Okay, this is the statement what they show. This type of, again, then log the size, log of size should be roughly the entropy of the random variable, which is the case here. And the last one says, the last item can be strengthened and can be said exactly in the way that I said, but now I just multiplied it by It's inverse, so the G cancels out G inverse. So it will be almost equidistributed inside H itself. Okay, so is that clear? So this is a very important part of Alec Bugan-Gambert work. This type of result goes back to additive combinatorics works of Gowers, Balazs-Zimmeridy, and then Tony Chow observed that he showed that those techniques are robust enough to be applied in non-commutative setting. And then essentially what Tony Chow showed is the same result, but under the assumption that X and Y are equidistributed and are distributed under support, are equidistributed under support. So he starts with two sets, A and B, and takes X and Y with a uniform distribution on these two sets, A and B, and then he proves the same type of result as Bugan and Gambert. So this result of Bugan and Gambert can be viewed as a weighted version of Tao's, Gower's, and Balazs-Zimmeridy's result. Okay, so now what? So this kind of give us a machinery of gaining entropy. So each time that I do random walk, I gain entropy unless I'm trapped in some approximate subgroup. What if my entropy is very large? Then what? So then it's Gower's quasi randomness plus Sarnak-Shu trick. I mean, Sarnak and Shu had used this kind of high multiplicity argument and trace argument prior to Gower's quasi-randomness, but Gower's made it axiomatic and in fact used this in order to prove certain product statement, which was asked. So what is the statement? What is the definition? A finite group G is called D quasi-random if any non-trivial irreducible representation of G has dimension at least capital D. If this is the case, then we call it D quasi-random. And the reason that he called it quasi-random is because he constructed bipartite graphs where the vertices are elements of G, and then he took very large subsets, and then he looked at the neighbors to be multiples of the element by these subsets, and he showed statistically it looks like a random graph. So that's why he called it quasi-random. And when I say statistically, essentially he proved this mixing inequality. And this factor here, it's a bit ugly. And the reason that we have it here is because we are working with a counting measure. If we were working with probability counting measure, then we didn't have this. Yeah, it would have been a very nice contraction with a square root D as a factor. But it is what it is. We get this kind of mixing. And now, this mixing helps us to deduce the following, that if after log G step random walk, my entropy gets very close to entropy of the equidistribution. That means after L step, the entropy is one minus delta naught half times log of the cardinality. And then my Lyapunov exponent has a lower bound that just depends on these parameters, delta naught and C naught. So that's the key thing. So this means here is our target. Here is our target entropy. We want to gain entropy a bit using the previous result. Using here, I want to do random walk, gain entropy again and again and again, till I reach to this target entropy over here, and that would finish existence of my spectral gap. Okay, now, this idea helps Bugan and Gambert to prove this. I mean, essentially, this argument gives us this machinery that if I impose this condition on the group G, that G is G to power delta naught quasi-random, I understand its approximate subgroups. All approximate subgroups are closed to groups. Now, two conditions on the random variable. First of all, I have some initial entropy. So I have some some constant times log of cardinality initial entropy of my random variable. So that would be my initial C. Now I want to add to it a bit and a bit in order to reach to my target entropy. But along the way, I have to avoid these algebraic obstruction. So that would be my Diophantine property. So you can think about it like, so I call it Diophantine property because it's like some irrational rotation. So I have irrational rotation. What is Diophantine property of a number? It means how close can it get to some closed orbit in the circle. So what is the probability of hitting the neighborhood of a subgroup? So it's quite like that here. So what is the probability of hitting a proper subgroup? If it was uniform distributed, it would have been precisely 1/(index). So here we don't know that, but maybe some small power of that. If we have such a thing, we call it the Diophantine property. What Bourguin and Gambaud show by the scheme that I explained is that if you have initial entropy and Diophantine property and those properties and the group, just depending on these constants, you get a very good lower bound for your Lyapunov exponent. So in particular, if you gain initial entropy and Diophantine property in logarithmic steps, you get your spectral bound. Okay, so that's the upshot of Bourguin-Gambaud technique. So the whole process now ends up being, how can I prove the initial entropy and Diophantine property in logarithmic steps? How can I gain such properties? So when the in SL2FP case, when the girth was large, the girth largeness immediately gives you initial entropy, and combined with understanding of proper subgroups of SL2FP, the fact that they are quite solvable, you can show the Diophantine property in the case of SL2FP. That's why the girth condition was enough in order to gain both of these conditions. But when you go, okay, so when you go to, so the approximate subgroup case had been handled by two groups, Pieper and Zabo, Bourguin, Green, and Tao. So they told us that in fact, when G is semi-simple, when I look at the finite field points of the semi-simple group, then approximate subgroups are closed subgroups. So they told us that condition. But the Diophantine and initial Diophantine property and initial entropy, so far we can handle only when we have certain integrality in picture. So for instance, if I start with some gamma where the entries are already inside Z joint with 1/Q0, then in that case, in joint work with Vario and myself, I can show that if I look at the Zariski closure, if the connected component is perfect, which means the commutator is itself, then mod powers of primes or fixed powers of square free numbers, we get a family of exponents. This is a kind of generalization of the, I mean, of course, when G is semi-simple and gamma is arithmetic, we do have these properties. So we get these statements as well. But it is crucial that we have this Z joint with 1/Q0. So those are the kind of things that help us to deduce initial entropy and Diophantine property. So this effective Nullstellen type of result come to the picture in a very important way. Even in other compact groups, it's the same phenomena. That so works of Bourguin-Gambaud, Benoit de Saxet, or myself, when we want to understand random walks in other compact groups like SU2, SUD, or other compact simple Lie groups, or compact semi-simple periodic analytic groups. So all these, we have to start with measures that have algebraic entries as the initial in their support initially. And that's, again, in the spirit of these Diophantine property that I was pointing out. So in those cases, we get a spectral. So now the game is, how can I get Diophantine property without this initial input? So one example of this type is this setting that I have, I look at the affine special group, I mean, special affine group, SLN FP, semi-direct product FP to the N. I take a generating set. Let's assume that when I look at it, mod the unipotent, mod the translation part. Let's assume that in that case, I get a family of expanders. Can I deduce that I have a family of expanders up there for the affine translations, I mean, for the affine group? This is a question that Linden, Strass, and Barrio ask. And they were kind of motivated by the group of isometries of Euclidean space. So it goes back to the work of Kajdan, where he studied random walk by isometries on Euclidean space, and he wanted to understand spectral gap property of that random walk. And so what Linden, Strass, and Barrio, they also study is that under the assumption that only the SON part of it has a spectral gap with no information a priori on the translation part, what can I say about the random walk on the Euclidean space? That was a kind of infinite object parallel of the same question. Having some information on the linear part, what can you deduce on the semi-direct product part? And knowing that SLNFP has formed expanders immediately gives you the initial entropy. So that's not a problem anymore. And because SLNFP, it was essentially parts of my work with Varu as well, we used understanding of approximate subgroups of SLNFP in order to understand approximate subgroups of the semi-direct product. So that part was also handled prior to the work of Linden, Strass, and Barrio. So the key thing was the Diophantine property. So the question was, how can we handle the Diophantine property of such a random walk? So this means one has to first study proper subgroups. So if I give you a proper subgroup of SLNFP, semi-direct product FP to the N, if the projection to the SLNFP part is not onto, then it's easy because we can just use random walk in the SLNFP part and escape from that subgroup. So this means I have to focus on subgroups that map onto SLNFP. But there are not many of them because the action of SLNFP on FP to the N is actually an irreducible action. So if there is any kind of translation, then I get the entire group. So this means the only proper subgroups that they had to take care of are those ones that are kind of conjugate of SLNFP. So if you use a certain vanishing of cohomology of SLNFP, you can show that what they have to only work with conjugates of SLNFP and try to avoid them. But dynamically, what does that mean? If you consider the affine action of this affine group, those groups are precisely stabilizers of points inside the affine space. So this means they have to consider the affine random walk, and they have to show that there is a non-concentration statement, that they have to show that the probability of hitting every point will decrease substantially. It will be 1 over p to some power. Okay, so this is what they essentially do. And now what do we do? This is what we prove, which is a generalization of their work. So suppose that I start with a perfect group that's connected. Then this G, okay, let me write it down. Then this G is known to be semi-direct product of a semi-simple group and a unipotent group. So it is mapped onto the semi-simple group. Now suppose I give you a generating set of this perfect group. And let S sub P bar be the projection to H of S sub P. So what we show is that if you tell me, then assume that the cardinality is fixed. So what we show, joint with my graduate students, so if the KD graphs of HFP and S of P bars form a family of expanders, then this is a family of expanders. Now, if you have not worked with perfect groups that much, let me point out, I mean, a very concrete criterion in order to get a perfect group. The criterion is that if I give you H a semi-simple group and a unipotent group, and assume that H acts on this unipotent group, and the action is in a way that when I look at the action on the abelianization of U, it has no non-zero fixed points. No non-zero fixed points, then the semi-direct product is perfect. This is if and only if. Non-zero fixed points. This is in fact if and only. So again, even, I mean, this statement that we are proving over here, this is by itself is even, it's non-trivial even when you consider SL2 semi-direct product a vector space where the action, where the fixed points of a vector, I mean, where the fixed points is zero with no non-zero fixed points. So this is a perfect group. I give you a representation of SL2 with no non-zero fixed points. I look at the semi-direct product. This is a good example where the method of and the result of Lindenstrom's embargo did not work. So here it was actually very crucial in their work that it is the same dimension as SLNFP, because they used crucially the fact that SFP to the N consists of two orbits, zero and everything else. So this was a crucial ingredient in their work, so they could not work with sparse orbits. But here we are working with arbitrary dimension, usable representation, but fixed one, of course. Orbits will be rather very small, but curvy inside B, and we get this result. So in the remaining time, I briefly say some of the steps, some of the ideas in the proof. Is there any question on the statement? Is the statement clear? Okay, so the first trick is, at the end of the day, we want to work with the linear part. That's our assumption. Okay, so maybe the zero trick, the zero step is, when you want to understand, okay, so the zero step is because of the works that I've mentioned of Bugan and Gambert. The main point is again the Diophantine property. So we want to gain the Diophantine property. That means we want to escape proper subgroups. So first we need to understand what are proper subgroups. Again, a combination of Norrie's result plus the fact that if the linear part is not onto, then I can escape them. One can prove certain cohomological statements and so on. At the end, we can, so let me explain it a bit better over here. So as I've explained over here, my perfect group looks like this. And as you can see, it's already perfect when I abelianize U. So instead of working with an arbitrary unipotent group, I start working with abelian representations, or if in fact only something like this, where the action of H has no non-zero fixed points. So when you start with this, then using the well-known techniques in group theory, you can extend understanding of this abelian group to the understanding of the entire unipotent group. So this is a well-known technique that these sequence of lower triangular series. This gives you a Lie algebra that is generated by the degree one guy, and the degree one guy is precisely the abelianization of U. So that's why I'm going to focus only on the case where the unipotent group is abelian. Okay, so that means I'm giving you a representation of my irreducible guy H with no non-zero fixed points. Now what I want to do, I want to escape proper subgroups. Again, using group theory, we can understand proper subgroups, say that all the proper subgroups look like a semi-direct product like this, maybe a conjugate of them, where W is a submodule of V. So this means I have to escape affine spaces as I do random walk in the affine space. So we need to escape affine subspaces as we do random walk on V. Okay, how can we do that? We use Fourier analysis on V. So we show that as we do random walk, the Fourier inverse of the distribution gets flattened. I mean, it converges to kind of the Dirac at delta naught. So if it was distributed completely, it would have been, the Fourier inverse would have been the Dirac mass. So now this is what we want to show. We are going to look at the Fourier inverse, and we want to show a contraction in the Fourier world. Why the Fourier is helpful? The reason is the first trick. The point is that when I look at the Fourier, then the translation is just multiplication by some root of unity. So when I take the absolute value, the translation disappears, and I get an upper bound on the convolution of the absolute value. So absolute value of the Fourier inverse of some random walk on the semi-direct product is like the convolution of only the linear part. So that's how you can bring in the spectral gap of the linear part into the picture. Now, the linear part, we have a spectral gap. So after L step, it should get close to distribution. Now, it is close is in terms of the L2 norm. In this work, it turns out that we have to work with larger norm, Ln norms, for some fixed n, but very large. So using least Thorin interpolation, we can say that, okay, so this spectral gap can be translated, and we can approximate this L-fold convolution by averaging along the H orbits. H is the linear part. So by averaging, so P sub H is the averaging operator. So the Ln norm can be approximated, and because it's averaging, when I shift it by some H, it should not change that much. So again, by this restoring interpolation, we can get this kind of result. Now, so this means I have to focus on the averaging operator in the Fourier inverse. But what is averaging operator? This means I'm dealing with these kind of exponential sums. So as I look at the orbit of H, I give you a character on this vector space V. I give you a vector V naught, and I look at the H orbit of V naught, and I look at the exponential sum along this H orbit, and how much cancellation I have. So I mean, you can imagine that I'm essentially, I mean, roughly, very roughly, I'm looking at the variety G over H, I mean H over the stabilizer. And I'm looking at, I'm cheating over here, of course, but I'm looking at the FP points of this. And now I'm looking at this exponential sum. So if it was actually like this and it was a projective variety, then Dolin would have given us a beautiful exponential cancellation. This is not the case here, but nevertheless, we still get some exponential cancellation. And in this case, in fact, you can write it in terms of a first order logic statement. Being inside an orbit can be written in terms of a first order logic statement. And then one can use Kowalski's result, which has been done in this quite generality about exponential cancellations. So at the end, one can get this kind of exponential cancellation as long as the entire H orbit is not a subset of the kernel of chi. You get this much cancellation when we do average. So this means what? This means if I view any vector v as a function on the Fourier space, in the dual of the dual, then the averaging along the H orbit of this function, the n-naught norm has this much contraction. What is mv? This is the module generated by v, the module generated by v. So we get quite a lot of cancellation, and we get, as if it was the entire averaging along the H orbit, we get certain flatness for these averages. Now this helps us to deduce that if I start with a probability measure eta, and then I look at the Fourier inverse of that and take the averaging along the H orbit, then the n-naught norm has this upper bound. This means either it has certain concentration at zero, or it's very small. So if it's not concentrated at zero, then I have a very good upper bound for it. So this tells me that I get a kind of a statement about having no almost invariant function type of thing, but in not world. But now I have to translate it in terms of contraction. And this is done in using the fact that I have uniform convexity in L naught spaces. So these are the main ingredients that play a crucial role, but in a technical way. So it's not one of them. But I mean, one conceptual thing that I want to emphasize before I end my talk is the following, that this step from here to here it has similarity with circle method. I mean, in circle method, you often get a very small cancellation. Then you often tensor it. You often go to larger space in order to gain cancellation as much as you want. Here, we could not tensor it. So it's not like the usual LP space, and then you tensor it in order to get into L2 space. Here, because we could not enlarge the size of the space, we changed the norm, and then we worked with N naught norm in order to get the needed cancellation. So this step has some resemblance with the circle method, but in a non-direct way. So we have a small cancellation, and then we interpolate it kind of by looking at the N naught norm. So I stop at this point.
Thank you very much. Okay. Are there any questions? Well, if not, let's unmute and thank the speaker.
So I'm going to stop the recording.